As cars have made more and more power here at World Time Attack, we've needed to look at more technology in the ECU in order to control and manage that power, making it easier for the driver to get it to the ground and obviously, ultimately, get faster lap times. We're here with Sean from Ramsdell Racing, who's the tuner for the Dream Project S15, to talk about some of these technologies. So, for a start, maybe if we rewind a little bit, conventional ECU technology and how we would control power, or more accurately, torque production.
Yeah.
So, what were the levers we had available? How was this done?
Boost overgear. That will do 90% of the work. It's pretty good. It will get most cars that aren't traction limited, like pretty much as far as they need to go. When you're really starting to narrow down on how much can we get in that gear at that speed, then you start to, you know, you'll have like an RPM over gear in every gear, and then it starts to get a bit messy.
Okay, so essentially what we're doing there is saying that in first and second gear, we're not going to be able to put as much torque to the ground as we can in third, fourth, or fifth.
Correct.
So that's why we're changing the boost targets. And I think this is probably something that, you know, it's pretty well understood.
Pretty commonplace, yeah.
There's another element to this, though, that I think is a little bit more subtle and less understood, and that is the relationship between the driver's foot pedal position and the amount of torque that the engine's producing.
Yes.
And traditionally, this is not linear. So can you talk to us a little bit about what that means and why it can be problematic?
Yeah, so if you can have, especially in a boosted engine, you can have full power at full throttle, and then you can have 50% throttle and make exactly the same power. You can have 30% throttle and make exactly the same power. So if you're trying to, if the driver, say you oversteer and it slips and the driver has to get off the pedal, he has to go from 100 to 30 before anything happens. So yeah, that's the nuts and bolts of it, yeah.
Naturally, if I'm at 100% throttle and I want to maybe halve the torque, I would think that going to 50% throttle is going to achieve that aim. But of course, as you mentioned, that's absolutely not the case.
Yeah.
Now, if we look at modern technology, and in this case, you're an EMtron specialist. This is a car fitted with an EMtron ECU.
Yep.
Can you talk about what EMtron have developed that makes this a little bit more controllable? Actually, a lot more controllable.
Yeah, so the current EMtron traction control, and I say that because it's constantly developing, uses tractive force calculation. So then we know we have a tractive force at the tyre, and then we tell it the tyre diameter, the diff ratio, the gearbox ratios. We know our engine torque from throttle mass flow, and then we can very accurately pick our engine torque to get the correct tractive force at the tyre.
Okay, you've just thrown a huge number of terms in there, so I think we need to just go back and unpack each of those individually. First of all, reasonably intuitive, but let's just explain in a bit more detail what tractive force actually means.
So tractive force is, we use it as in as the point where the tyre will lose good grip with the surface that it's on.
So essentially the maximum amount of torque that the tyre can put to the track at any
yes.
particular time.
That in a number. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is this something that's taking into account the likes of lateral and longitudinal G-force? Because obviously this is changing. What we could put to the rear tyre when we're in a straight line at 200 kilometres an hour with downforce is going to be different to what we can do in a low-speed corner where we're at corner exit and really the car's traction limited.
Yeah, so we use literally that lateral G and we have a downforce correction which will actually change our target engine torque, which will then affect our target tractive force. So then the good side of that for me dealing with Rob, the driver, is we can pinpoint lateral Gs where he might want a little bit less or a little bit more throttle response or power, or and it just opens up this 3D window that you can work with as power delivery instead of just boost over gear.
Now, on face value, what we're talking about here is an incredibly complex system to model. You know, there's a lot of moving parts to this.
Yes.
And I'm thinking if you wanted to model it to the nth degree and have something that's absolutely perfect, it's going to then be almost certainly outside the scope of the average or even a very advanced tuner to be able to input all of the correct details. So how have EMtron kind of walked that tightrope between getting the model to work but also yep. making it simple enough that the average tuner can actually get it right?
So the way the EMtron does it is it says pick a gear and pick the torque. and just start there. So when I first did this car, I accidentally did the torque management, traction control, because I had data from Queensland Raceway in Queensland. I actually had some good oversteer slip data, which I put into the ECU. You know, it might have been 600 newton meters in second gear or whatever. Put all that data in, had everything really, really well set up. Came to the track here last year and actually had an error in my wheel speeds, and it thought it had 5% slip the whole track. So it was in Tractive Force traction control the whole time. And it came back in and I'm just like, I have no idea what's going on.
And that is actually one of the problems from a tuning perspective of when you've got a really complex model where there's a lot of inputs and something's not working, sometimes it can be quite difficult to go and reverse engineer and find out where you've got something wrong.
Yeah, so once I worked out what was actually happening, I was like, sweet. So we've got 600 newton meters in second. The ECU knows that our gearbox ratio is 2:1. If we change to third, the ECU knows the ratio change in the gearbox. So it knows exactly how much torque to put in the next gear. Even to the point as to have a flat tractive torque curve, you have to have a flat torque curve. So if your torque starts to fall over as you rev the engine, it will actually target more boost to get you back to that flat torque curve as the engine RPM increases.
Understandable. It was, again, a lot of moving parts in this. And essentially what you're talking about here is targeting a specific engine torque in order to get the multiplication factor through the gear that you're in, the final drive ratio to get the torque at the tyre. And that's the part
force at the tyre. So ultimately, if you have enough power, your tractive force should come up to a number, be it 10,000, 11,000. And if you can keep putting power in and it stays flat, then that's like perfect.
Obviously not always the case. At some point, probably we're going to run out of power or torque to produce. All right, just coming back, you also mentioned the tune. I think we've got tractive force kind of dialed in. We understand that. Now, you've also talked about throttle mass flow, and that's going to be a term that probably most people watching won't have heard. So can you explain that and try and keep it as simple as we can?
It's a flow of airflow through the throttle using pre-throttle pressure, post-throttle pressure, and the size of the throttle body. And that's pretty much it. But from that airflow, we can very accurately calculate engine torque, fuel demand, all that sort of stuff. So in order to get the correct engine torque to get our correct tractive force, we have to be able to get to that torque. And that's where throttle mass flow is really, really good, is that at those partial throttles, when it's coming up onto boost, lower gears, that sort of stuff, that throttle mass flow model is really important.
So in other words, the ECU knows for a given torque request exactly what throttle opening it needs to go to in order to achieve that.
Yeah. I've done a lot of it with automatic transmission cars as well. So I actually got rid of their gear torque and just did literally torque over gear and sent some of my roll racing cars out. And then when I got the data back, even with converter slip and everything else, the tractive force number was the same. So then I knew I validated the data, and then we could use the EMtron traction control in an automatic transmission roll racing car.
Now, another aspect we talked about there as well was the relationship traditionally where the driver's foot pedal position is not necessarily going to be linear to the torque produced.
Yes.
We do now have the ability with the throttle mass flow model to basically map torque to the driver's foot pedal position, correct?
Yes.
So now we've got a much more linear relationship where we can change that relationship to suit the driver's personal preferences.
Yeah, so as the if you're at full throttle and you release 80% of the pedal, we can literally target 80% of the torque.
It's going to essentially make it much easier for the driver to handle a car that can at any position put more torque to the track than the tyre can take.
100%, yeah.
In terms of the actual traction control over and above this, because this is essentially trying to model the available traction and then target sort of there or thereabouts, what does the ECU then do if you do happen to get into a wheel spin situation in order to reduce the torque? Is this going to simply close the throttle, or are you starting to look at torque reductions via ignition cut, fuel cut, or ignition retard, or is it all of the above?
You can choose any combination of however you want to do it. The way I normally do it is trying in the lower gears where I know I'm going to have a problem area, I'll try and keep the throttle right on that point of being a restriction but not being a restriction. So then if we do need to close it, we close it really quickly. But I actually use timing first. Timing first, it's the next engine cycle. If the timing can't fix it, then we start to introduce ignition or a fuel cut, and that hammers it on the head straight away.
So let's just dive into that in a bit more detail. So what you're saying there is essentially the driver might be at wide open throttle, but as we've already talked about, the engine is going to be able to produce the maximum power at 100% throttle, but probably also 80% or maybe 70%. So we sort of get it down to the actual throttle body will be closed to that point where it's still making maximum power, but now if we need to reduce the torque, it can close the throttle just a little. Instantly, we're getting a reaction. But even then, there's going to be a few milliseconds for that to happen, but ignition retard will be instantaneous.
Yeah, so there is a latency in the throttle, and it's actually programmed into the EMtron that you give it a priority list. So you say, I want to use the throttle first, then I want to use ignition, then I want to use cut. While it's waiting for the throttle, it will actually pull timing. And then as the throttle gets to that correct position and it's at the correct torque, then it will decay its timing retard and put it back in.
So essentially, it's got a lot of levers available that it can use in order to achieve the required torque, and then it can change those as everything catches up.
Yeah, but really easy to set up, like crazy easy to set up.
On that note, when you're dealing with an EMtron using throttle mass flow, does it massively change the sort of workflow for you as a tuner compared to a conventional ECU?
Maybe a minute.
Okay, so really, really, there's nothing to
ask. Yeah, and once you model one throttle, and I tried it one day, I did a SR20 with a 74mm Bosch. I did a 2J with a 74mm Bosch and literally dropped my throttle flow table in and it worked. It was because it's the flow. So that's, yeah.
Once it's done, it's easy. I guess with that in mind, if it is so simple, there's no additional real work for you as a tuner. Is this something that you would apply then to everything that you tune?
Everything. Because even in the EMtron, the idle is grams per second. It's done by the throttle mass flow. So everything that is drive-by-wire gets throttle mass flow.
Now, on face value for us in the aftermarket tuning industry, this seems like a massive step forward and really maybe some kind of witchcraft in a little bit of a way. The reality is, though, this is what OEs have essentially been doing in the factory world for a long time.
Yeah. And from what I've seen, it was sort of born from the GDR plugin, which is throttle mass flow, which needs really accurate engine torque figures, obviously, to control the gearbox. And then it's just spawned from there. And then once you have that throttle mass flow to predict engine torque, then you can also reverse the throttle to get two-way specific engine torque. And it's sort of done full circle, but now it's quite easy to punch in a number. I know that that's going to work, and then it just fixes everything else.
So ultimately, it's an amazing technology, but we shouldn't feel too clever because we're just following what the OEs have been doing for probably better than a decade. Yeah. We've just been a little bit slow on the uptake.
I almost feel like I'm cheating sometimes. But we did a diff ratio change. And we were like, oh, we're not too sure what's going to happen with the car. So, and I have a little spreadsheet that just works out the tractive force. And I just punched in the new diff ratio and it just spat me out a number that I needed in second gear. And I'll just put that number in and lo and behold, it's correct.
I mean, again, there's no real magic here. It's just torque with a multiplication factor for a gear or a diff ratio or both.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah.
All right, look, it's been great to get some insight into this technology. Obviously, it's not going to be for everyone right now, but I guess watch this space because this is probably the future of the aftermarket standalone ECU industry. Thanks for your time, Sean.
Oh, thank you.
like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.